Sapir Andor, mesdames et messieurs, chers collègues, chers étudiants, Ramona Coman, notre nouvelle directrice, et moi-même sommes ravis de pouvoir vous accueillir ici pour la rentrée académique de l'Institut d'études européennes. Ramona Coman, our new director, and myself are very honored to welcome you all to this event. It's a real privilege and a pleasure to open this academic year with such a prestigious guest as Commissioner Laszlo Andor and with such a distinguished panel. As we all know, 2014 is a key year for the European institutions because of the European Parliament's elections and, of course, because of the changes within the European Commission. It is also a key year for our institute since it celebrates its 50th anniversary and since it goes through an important reform. As Didier Vivier, the rector of the university, underlined, this reform will allow us to strengthen both the research and the education programs in the field of European studies. European studies will remain an essential priority of the Université Libre de Bruxelles, University of Europe. This conference fits perfectly into the tradition of this institute. Indeed, it corresponds to one of its main purposes, which is to be a place where public debates are held on important and topical European issues. The subject matter of this evening is certainly one of the key issues for the future of EU integration. Moreover, the composition of this panel also illustrates one of the main aims of this institute, which is to bring together academics and researchers on the one hand, and policymakers and EU institution representatives on the other. Our first speaker is Commissioner Laszlo Andor. Commissioner Andor is an economist. He studied at the Budapest University of Economic Sciences, at the University of Manchester, and at George Washington University in Washington, D.C. He holds a PhD in economics from the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. He wrote his dissertation on the theoretical approaches to the international debt crisis. He is associate professor at the Department of Economic Policy at the Corvinus University of Budapest. Since February 2010, as you know, he has been Commissioner for Employment, Social Affairs and Inclusion. His mandate has particularly been marked by his will to face the crisis and the recession in the Eurozone, by his will also to promote and develop the European social model and to pursue stronger employment and social performances and institutions. To mention only a few of Commissioner Andor's achievements, I would like to stress the launch of the Youth Guarantee, which is now being implemented across Europe, and the agreement on a strong European Social Fund for 2014-2020. Commissioner Andor, the second Commission Barroso, had obviously benefited from your academic background. You have largely contributed to reorient, should I say, reinvent European employment and social policies and agenda. You have even been portrayed by some as being the one who reintroduced some Keynesianism in the temple of the neoliberal orthodoxy. You did not simply produce in-depth analysis of the dysfunctioning of the monetary union. You have also, and above all, developed new concrete tools in an area of policies still considered by some as strict national competences. We therefore look forward to your lecture on imbalances and inequalities in the EU. Following your presentation, we will listen to the reaction of Professor André Sapir. André Sapir is professor at the Solvay Brussels School of Economics and Management, and also senior fellow at the Brussels European and Global Economic Laboratory, also known as Breguet. He was president of this institute from 92 to 98. André Sapir has a quite impressive career. He was, for instance, a member of the Economic Advisory Group of the European Commission's President Barroso between 2005 and 2010, economic advisor to the previous Commission President Prodi between 2001 and 2004, and among his numerous scientific publications, I would of course like to mention the Agenda for Growing Europe, a report for the President of the Commission written by a group of independent experts, also known as the Sapir Report, which was published in 2004. We will then hear the reaction of Andrea Garnero, a brilliant PhD candidate at the École Normale Supérieure of Paris and at the ULB. He has been working on his PhD since 2011, and his PhD dedicated to institution and heterogeneity in the labor market, and he should complete it by the end of this year. Besides the publication of a series of scientific articles, Andrea Garnero worked for the Italian Prime Minister, Enrico Letta, and he worked also previous to that within the Directorate General for Employment, Social Affairs and Equal Opportunities. Time will finally be devoted to a discussion with the audience, discussion that will be chaired by Ramona Coman, our director. One of the main features of the Institute for European Studies is its interdisciplinarity. And this feature will be further strengthened with the current reform. Tonight's speakers are all economists. This is because this year we really wanted to stress the crucial role of economists in European studies. However, the audience is of course composed of academics, researchers, and students coming from different disciplines. History, political sciences, law, sociology, etc., who all share an interest in the economic and social transformations of Europe. I'm sure that the questions and observations coming from the audience will reflect its interdisciplinarity and give rise to an interesting and fruitful discussion. This being said, I would like to thank very sincerely the speakers for having accepted to take part in this event, and I give now the floor immediately to Commissioner Andor.
Dear professors, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, let me thank you for the invitation, for this opportunity to present to you and then discuss some important issues of the current situation in the European Union, which allows me to look backwards, but also to look a little bit ahead in terms of the performance of the European economy, the state of the European society, and how I see it from the office which I have had. It's really an honor to speak at the beginning of the academic year in this major university and this prestigious institute. I think an interdisciplinary approach is just the right way to speak about economic developments and their social as well as political consequences. Indeed, without looking at all these dimensions, you cannot really find out what is the essence of the tensions underlying the European situation today, and what the possible alternatives are if we want to consider the options ahead of us. I will speak about major socio-economic imbalances in the European Union, specifically between member states, in particular inside the Eurozone, and I will also discuss rising social inequalities within some EU member states, and I would like to convince you about the connection between these two problems, the Eurozone crisis on the one hand and rising social inequalities on the other hand. The high levels of income inequality are certainly a problem from the viewpoint of social fairness and cohesion, and they practically invalidate the notion of equal opportunities, which is a principle we probably all share. Inequalities have been on the rise since the 1970s in many countries of the world, including in Europe. But in many European countries, inequalities have risen more sharply in the context of the macroeconomic adjustment during the Eurozone crisis. In some EU member states, various measures of inequality show no change or even improvement. This means that a serious divergence has developed between the core and the periphery of what we call the Eurozone. This divergence is not only serious, in my view, it is also dangerous for the stability of the monetary union and the cohesion of the European Union as a whole. I will therefore argue that in order to reverse this trend, many member states, first of all, need to strengthen their employment and social policies. Without more solidarity, trends of rising inequality cannot be reversed. But I would also like to emphasize that in order to combat socioeconomic imbalances and divergence within the EMU, the EMU itself also has to be reconstructed, in particular through the creation of a counter-cyclical fiscal capacity. Let me first of all discuss and show you a few slides about the impact of the so-called sovereign debt crisis in the euro area and the divergence it unleashed. The last 5 years have been dominated by the worst financial, economic and social crisis in the history of the European Union, a crisis that is only comparable to the Great Depression of the 1930s, and a crisis that should never have happened and which we should certainly never have to go through again. More accurately, Europe has gone through not one, but two crises. The effects of the first financial and economic crisis in 2008 and 2009 were felt by the world as a whole. It did not even originate from the Eurozone. The second, the so-called Eurozone recession since 2011, from which we still have not fully recovered, has been something unique to Europe and stemmed from shortcomings in the design of the Economic and Monetary Union. Nowhere else in the industrialized world did something similar happen. When the global financial and economic crisis worsened in autumn 2008, that's still the first crisis which Europe, so to speak, imported, the EU governments agreed to coordinated measures in order to stimulate the economy, including by increasing the national budget deficits on a temporary basis, of course. This came to be known as the European Economic Recovery Package. The fiscal stimulus was partly discretionary and partly the work of so-called automatic stabilizers within national budgets, namely, reduced tax revenue and increased social expenditures at the cost of increased budget deficit. This stimulus helped to generate a recovery in GDP and to reduce unemployment in 2010. But while the United States of America continued to experience a robust and job-rich recovery afterwards, the European Union actually nosedived into a second recession in 2011. This is what you can see on this chart, the decoupling of the economic trends between Europe and the United States. The reason for this decoupling, in my view, was that the EMU, as it was originally designed, had been unprepared to handle a sovereign debt crisis of some smaller member states. It had no lender of last resort, no collective framework for resolving bad debt, and no mechanism for managing aggregate demand in the economy. Deaths from financial markets were replaced by deaths from official sources, practically other sovereign countries, which turned the Eurozone into a club of debtors and creditors set against each other. We entered this double dip recession in 2011, accompanied by capital flight from less stable countries towards more stable ones, causing further financial and economic polarization. The Eurozone crisis, as it deepened, produced a dramatic rise in unemployment. And although we have experienced some improvement in the last 12 months, unemployment in Europe remains still much higher today than at the peak of the first recession in 2010. On the slide, you can see this increasing levels of unemployment, the temporary improvement in 2010, and the further very sharp rise at the time of the Eurozone crisis. The sovereign debt crisis cast the monetary union and the EU as a whole into an existential crisis. The EU only started to emerge from this financial maelstrom when the European Central Bank announced in 2012 that it was ready to launch its outright monetary transaction program, and the presidents of the European Council, the Commission, the European Central Bank, and the Eurogroup came forward with a long-term plan for revamping the economic and monetary union. The sovereign debt crisis has shown that without a lender of last resort, a central budget, or a coordination arrangement geared to stabilizing aggregate demand at the level of the Eurozone, our economic and monetary union had been designed for fair weather at best, but not for the storm of a financial and economic crisis. Emergency lending to troubled countries was always agreed at the last minute. But the EMU has proven to be a trap which countries learned at this period in terms of making it difficult and very costly to restore these countries' growth potential. The member states suffering from capital outflows could no longer support their economies through tailor-made monetary policies, because the monetary policy has been centralized in the European Central Bank, or currency devaluation, because everybody is using the same currency, while at the same time being subject to strict rules on fiscal policy and credit conditionalities, which at least partially turned out to be counterproductive. The contractionary effects of these strategies have put the EU at a competitive disadvantage in global terms. Furthermore, the Eurozone crisis has led to social consequences that cannot be acceptable in the European Union. You probably are aware that in 2010, the EU adopted a long-term strategy, the Europe 2020, for economic and social development, with headline targets about increasing the employment rate and reducing the number of people living in or at risk of poverty or social exclusion. As a consequence of this crisis, we actually moved away and not closer to these targets on employment and poverty reduction. The EU employment rate in 2010 was 70%, and by 2013 it actually fell to 68.3%. Also, in case of the poverty and social inclusion target, we had, so to speak, negative progress. The number of people in or at risk of poverty or social exclusion in 2010 was 118 million, but 124 million in 2012. And that's the latest reliable data which we have. The assumption is that since 2012, probably this number further increased. If you want to understand what this number is, you should know that this is a combination of three indicators. What we call at-risk of poverty, which is a relative poverty indicator. Secondly, it is material deprivation. And thirdly, the number of the jobless households. And obviously, there is an overlap between these three indicators, and what I'm speaking about is the aggregate, the number of people who are affected by at least one of the three indicators. But the point is that these aggregate figures, which I mentioned on employment or poverty, hide enormous disparities between the member states. Some countries like Austria or Germany, for example, are enjoying economic growth and relatively high employment. On the other hand, many other member states are struggling with continued economic contraction, with unemployment rates near or over 20%, and with declining household incomes and rising levels of poverty. Again, I would like to stress that these problems are connected, are concentrated in the euro area, which is bound together by the single monetary policy without a fiscal capacity. In the adjusting countries on the eurozone periphery, the second recession of 2011-13 meant rising long-term unemployment, poverty, social inequalities, and very significantly, emigration of many, many young people, often to other continents, not only to other European countries, which represents a human capital loss not only for these countries, but for the European Union as a whole. If we look at the divergence within the EMU in a longer-term perspective, we will see that today's socio-economic imbalances and disparities are actually without precedent since the launch of the Monetary Union more than two decades ago. This graph shows that unemployment for the countries that participated in the euro from the start, 12 countries, was on a path of convergence before the monetary union was established. It actually compares, on the one hand, the so-called north, or the core of the eurozone. It's not an identical expression, but very often in public discussions we speak about the north. It's more precise to speak about the core of the euro area, because in the north you also find so-called more peripheral economies like Ireland, for example. And on the other hand, you have the south or the periphery, and you probably are aware that Belgium falls into the first category, being probably relatively north and relatively central at the same time. The data goes back to the early 1990s in order to demonstrate that there was indeed a period of discrepancy but strong convergence. There was then a period when unemployment moved quite in the same rate and the same level if you compare the core countries and the peripheral countries of the Eurozone. But this was followed by a massive and unprecedented period of divergence, which is particularly strong during the second Eurozone recession. It didn't start at the time of the Greek crisis. It already started at the first financial crisis, but the trend became really sharp after 2010. We could analyze the situation also in terms of GDP developments instead of employment. This is visible here. Since the mid-1990s, there was almost a complete symmetry in the GDP trajectories of the north and the south of the Eurozone for over a decade, until the sovereign debt crisis erupted in 2010. Also, in this sense, the recent divergence within the EMU in terms of GDP is quite unprecedented. So the question is why Europe became so divided in terms of economic and social outcomes. The sovereign debt crisis since 2010 and the policies undertaken in response substantially weakened the power of the national welfare systems. This is a key part of the answer to this question. In particular, these measures weaken the effectiveness of the so-called national automatic fiscal stabilizers, which basically mean the ability of a state to immediately act in a countercyclical way as the tax revenues drop and the social revenue, the social expenditures increase. Until 2010, which you can see on this little complicated chart, what was clear, the national budgets always were able to counter the economic downturn by running deficits and applying transfers for those who lost their primary income. Since 2010, many national governments have lost this ability, and the so-called austerity policies, in many cases, actually aggravated the economic crisis. This means that instruments that were historically used to limit the social impact of crises were not available anymore, while there has been nothing newly introduced to replace them. Over several years, what we call internal revaluation was undertaken in an attempt to stabilize the troubled economies and to boost their economic competitiveness. When sovereign countries have their own national currencies, in case of a financial crisis, a currency revaluation takes place in order to ensure that the relative prices are lowered and the country regains competitiveness, and it applies in this case to all types of prices, including the prices of assets. When there is no possibility of a currency devaluation, what is available is the so-called internal devaluation to reduce various prices, but especially the price of labor. And the question is whether this is a mechanism which would be as good as currency devaluation in case you have a national currency. The point is that this so-called internal devaluation was applied simultaneously in many countries, which means that just like a competitive currency devaluation, the competitive internal devaluation could not deliver what was expected from it. Which practically means that if countries simultaneously reduce wages and public expenditure, they do not only improve their cost competitiveness, but they also at the same time reduce wages, they reduce demand in the economy, which undermines GDP growth. So practically all this develops into a vicious circle until something extraordinary happens in order to reverse this vicious cycle. In exceptional circumstances, I would like to add this, in exceptional circumstances, internal devaluation can be part of the solution, but there are many, many preconditions of that. For example, growing external markets, which is not necessarily the case if countries simultaneously adopt the same strategy. And even in those cases, there is a very high price to pay, and the rising inequality is a part of this high price which countries sometimes pay for external devaluation, but in particular for internal devaluation. This brings me to the analysis of inequality developments, especially what concerns inequality, income inequalities in Europe. This slide comes from the Commission's recent publication examining various measures of prosperity beyond GDP. It shows how the ratio of income inequality between the top quintile and the bottom quintile of the population have evolved during the crisis across the European Union. Unfortunately, the graph works with data only till 2011, so it does not capture subsequent increases in inequalities in countries like Latvia, for example. But it still gives a relatively good picture about how income inequalities have risen, especially in countries that experienced significant downturns. On the right-hand side, for example, Spain, Greece, Italy, and Hungary, as a matter of fact. We can also have a look at a few country examples of how income inequalities have evolved, and in order to explain better the difference between what we call the core and the periphery, let's have a closer look at two relatively large countries, Germany on the one hand and Spain on the other hand. Here we see that in Germany, growth in real income between 2006 and 2011 has been rather even across the income distribution, which means that the rich and the poor have experienced roughly the same, very mild income growth. By contrast, in Spain, the pre-crisis boom benefited the richest groups the most, and the financial and economic crisis had a hugely different impact on real incomes across the distribution. Especially the 20% of the people with the lowest incomes have experienced a massive drop in real incomes, while the top 40% were still as well off in 2011 as they had been in 2003. This graph points to many problems, including weaknesses in financial sector regulation, but it especially shows the low ability of the member state in question to mitigate adverse socio-economic developments through tax and expenditure policies. Ladies and gentlemen, the employment and social outcomes are probably decisive factors in the sustainability and legitimacy of the monetary union. This is why I have been drawing your attention to divergent developments in variables such as unemployment rates and income inequalities. The Commission and other players have been paying increasing attention to these problems in the context of the debate on the so-called social dimension of the economic and monetary union, which has been ongoing for about 2 years. The term social dimension of the EMU has been somewhat misleading, since the point is not to give the EU or the euro area competence for social policies. The point is to create conditions enabling to restore convergence in employment and social outcomes and other economic fundamentals throughout the currency union so that we strengthen the whole EMU's growth potential. Since the member states of a monetary union, as I already explained this, cannot unilaterally adjust to economic shocks through the exchange rate and the interest rate, unemployment and social crises are likely to develop to a greater extent within the currency union than outside it. The spillover effect of employment and social imbalances means that action, or the lack of action, as regards employment and social challenges, can affect other member states too. An employment crisis in one country translates into lower demand for other countries' products or services. A prolonged period of high unemployment also implies a loss of human capital that undermines future productivity and therefore the growth potential of the entire EMU. Moreover, social crises may also fuel political instability. Examples of this are not hard to find in today's Europe. For the first 2 decades of the EMU's history, employment and social problems did not really count as major concerns. The original design of the EMU did not take sufficient account of developments in the real economy and structural issues that are vital for the currency union to function properly. However, over the last 2 years, the recognition has grown that the EMU's economic governance needs to reflect social and employment challenges better in order to ensure that they are tackled in an effective and timely way before they blow out of proportion. That's why 1 year ago, the European Commission proposed and the Council endorsed the use of a scoreboard of key employment and social indicators in the European semester process. The scoreboard is incorporated into the annual joint employment report, published each autumn with the annual growth survey. It features five headline indicators that focus on employment and social trends, which can severely undermine employment, social cohesion, and human capital. These indicators are the following: the unemployment rate, the rate of young people neither in employment nor in education or training, which we also call the NEETs, and the youth unemployment rate in combination. The third one is the real gross disposable income of households. The fourth one is the at-risk of poverty rate of the working age population. And finally, the fifth one is the income inequality as determined by the S80-S20 ratio, which in practical terms compares the income of the top fifth of the population and the bottom 20%. You have already seen this indicator a few minutes ago. Now, what this scoreboard indicates today is growing divergence in employment and social development across the EU, and in particular within the euro area. Prior to the crisis, most social and employment performance indicators, not only unemployment, which I already showed, were converging across the EU. But since 2008, the gap has been growing wider, as we have already seen. The Commission used the findings of the scoreboard when drafting the 2014 staff working documents and country-specific recommendations during the 2014 European semester process. It has proven to be a useful tool, helping to identify which employment and social challenges need to be addressed and where. Therefore, I hope that this scoreboard will serve also our successors as they try to better reflect employment and social concerns in EU-level economic policy making. But, of course, this scoreboard is not enough, and I believe we have to look ahead what else follows from an analysis of divergences in the European Union, and especially inside the Eurozone, which means that the work has to continue to address the so-called design flaws of the Economic and Monetary Union, which would allow the EMU to better deal with its fundamental problems, which is the cyclicality of the economy and the asymmetries inside the Eurozone. In essence, our analysis shows that in the current form, the EMU is lacking the proper tools to manage these essential features of any economy, the asymmetry, the exposure to asymmetric shocks, and cyclicality. These challenges of asymmetry and cyclicality are relatively easily addressed if you have a flexible exchange rate system, but they are much more difficult to tackle in the currency union. Asymmetric shocks, by definition, cannot be mitigated by Eurozone-wide policies such as monetary policy, which is uniform. In the absence of a fiscal capacity that would mitigate asymmetries within the EMU, and in the absence of a coordinated adjustment by both deficit and surplus countries, the only available mechanism of adjustment turned out to be internal devaluation, which I already explained. This means that the reconstruction of the EMU has to go beyond the steps that have already been taken. The euro area crisis has led to the establishment of a permanent European stability mechanism that can bail out euro area member countries. A banking union has also been agreed and starts being put in place. This means that we have a framework for better resolving financial crises at the EMU level, and for reducing the risk of further bank bailouts with taxpayer money. But the main design flaws of the EMU, on the one hand the absence of a lender of last resort, and on the other hand the lack of a common fiscal capacity, still remain to be fixed. And in addition to these design flaws, we need to deal with the new problem of massive employment and social divergences, which had developed in the EMU during the crisis. This divergence is clearly at odds with the EU's treaty objectives of balanced economic growth, full employment, and social progress. Divergence in a monetary union is particularly dangerous when we lack tools to overcome it or to compensate for it. In a large macroeconomy, which is so diverse, it is supposed to be the role of fiscal policy to deal with the imbalances. But as you know, the European Union has a very small budget of only 1% of the total GDP. And within that budget, the EU cohesion policy, which is mainly geared towards the development of economically peripheral regions, amounts to only 0.4% of the EU GDP. And you also know that this is actually a budget for the EU 28, the older countries participating in the single market, and the cohesion policy aims at promoting long-term convergence, or at least preventing long-term divergence between countries and regions forming the single market. It's not supposed to be, in other words, a counter-cyclical instrument. By comparison, no budget exists at the level of the euro area, even though the bond of common currency is much stronger and reduces national autonomy much more than participation in the single market. For two decades, the member states have been willing to be bound together by a common currency with a single exchange rate and interest rate while not introducing any sort of fiscal risk sharing. Therefore, if we want to seriously reinforce the EMU and strengthen its resilience against economic shocks, we should, in my view, work on establishing a reliable mechanism for short-term, counter-cyclical fiscal transfers across the euro area member states. The European Commission's November 2012 blueprint for a deep and genuine economic and monetary union clearly envisaged the introduction of a fiscal capacity at the EMU level in the long term. The subsequent reports from the presidents of the European Council, the Commission, the European Central Bank, and the Eurogroup stated that such fiscal capacity should help the EMU to absorb economic shocks. The expert literature of the past few years has put forward a number of options for automatic fiscal stabilizers at monetary union level. Most of them share a focus on mitigating short-term cyclical downturns occurring in parts of the euro area, as opposed to compensating for structural differences. In other words, the point is to maintain spending at a sufficient level during a downturn before companies that struggle are turned around or replaced by new ones, and before workers who have lost their jobs can find new employment. Focusing fiscal transfers on mitigating asymmetrically distributed cyclical shocks means that over the long term, all participating member states are likely to be both contributors and beneficiaries of this scheme. This is a very important point because sometimes you hear the concern that any fiscal instrument or risk sharing would only mean cost for some and it would mean benefits for others. In reality, all countries would be on both sides of the equation in a certain period if we take a sufficiently long period. It's also important to state that, obviously, even in the long term, some would contribute more than they would benefit from such a stabilization mechanism, but this is the same already in the existing EU budget. Some contribute more, some are systematically net contributors, others are systematically net beneficiaries until their GDP catches up with the EU average. So, all in all, the best idea for automatic fiscal stabilizers among many options is probably a scheme which offers the greatest stabilization on the basis of development in short-term unemployment. Unemployment, as an indicator, has various advantages. it follows the developments in the economic cycle very close. It is very easily understandable for the citizens, and it can be measured easily and quickly. That's why a scheme focusing on unemployment would need to be introduced in order to respond to the fall in aggregate demand, and as opposed to structural unemployment caused by skill mismatches, less efficient labor market institutions, and the like. Separating cyclical from structural unemployment is the main consideration behind linking unemployment insurance with the functioning of the EMU. There have been many independent studies, apart from the studies of the Commission in the recent years, about the need and the justification for automatic stabilizers in one or another form. As I already said, all these studies point towards the involvement of all member states as being beneficiaries and not just contributors if we take a sufficiently long time. And all these studies also show that the overall growth potential of the European Economic and Monetary Union would be higher with an automatic stabilizer. There is no study which we would know about suggesting the opposite of this. It's also important to stress the automatic nature of the mechanism, which means a quick, immediate response to the economic downturn without unnecessary delays, which we have seen being so damaging in the recent years. In order to avoid misunderstanding, of course, such a mechanism would not eliminate the likelihood of economic shocks. Economic downturns would still happen in the European Union. The question is how quickly and how effectively we can intervene to mitigate the economic downturn, the resulting economic and social consequences. So all this also plays a role in favor of an automatic mechanism. This is certainly not a plan for, so to speak, more Europe for its own sake. Quite the contrary, an automatic stabilizer would help countries restoring their own national autonomy at a time when the national autonomy of many countries suffered so much under the Eurozone crisis. This would be one possible way to strengthen the EMU and prevent the very harmful divergences from developing and deepening further. It would represent a kind of safety net for the national welfare states, which have been weakened, as I already showed you through some figures previously. This could also help combating socio-economic inequalities, although it certainly would not replace the national redistributive policies, but it would provide a common core of stabilization, fiscal stabilization, and a safety net for national welfare systems to function. Ladies and gentlemen, what I spoke about is primarily the functioning or the malfunctioning of the Economic and Monetary Union in the recent years. But from the employment and the social portfolio, we had to pay a lot of attention to all these mechanisms because the social consequences were not simply painful in the more peripheral countries, but resulted in the divergences which created an entirely new experience for the European Union as a whole. And if you compare these outcomes to the objectives of the Europe 2020 strategy, we have shifted further away from the targets that were agreed in 2010 as opposed to getting closer to them. These Europe 2020 targets on employment, the poverty reduction at least, certainly cannot be realistically achieved without further reform of the monetary union, which means that the EMU has to be able to deal with asymmetries and economic downturns in other forms, in other ways, than what we call internal devaluation. And if the alternative implies cross-country transfers, we have to put this on the table for political discussions. Unemployment and poverty, as I explained during this crisis, have reached unacceptable levels, but beyond unemployment and poverty, we also need to pay attention to the rising inequalities as well. If we don't manage to undo the divergence that emerged within the EMU in the recent years, I believe the European Union countries would face further instability in social but also in political terms, which would result in a kind of disintegration process. And we hopefully will not risk such a scenario. In order to prevent such a disintegration from happening, I believe it is in everybody's interest to consider now what measures, what reforms need to be taken in the coming years in order to strengthen and rebalance the European Economic and Monetary Union. I thank you very much for your attention and look forward to hearing your views and questions.
Our students the differential impact of the crisis on the EU member states' domestic situation, economic situation, and also for explaining the complexity of the mechanisms and instruments elaborated at the EU level. Please allow me now to give the floor to Professor Sapir for the first comment on your speech. Thank you very much also, Professor Sapir, for being here today.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the pleasure and the opportunity to be here today and to give some remarks on the presentation by Commissioner Andor. And let me state right at the outset that I basically subscribe to what has been said. I certainly subscribe to the spirit of what has been said, what are the problems, the deep problems that we are facing, including in terms of unemployment and in terms of inequality. This is certainly unacceptable, and that certainly requires action. So I subscribe to the to the spirit. I subscribe to almost, not entirely, but to almost everything that has been made in terms of proposals. So I'm just going to organize my comments under five points. Point number one, the European Union, called differently then, started with six countries. We are today 28 countries, and certainly the degree of economic, social, even political diversity, but what concerns us today is sort of the economic and social diversity has increased substantially since the early days. And the big change came first in the 1980s, when Greece, then later Portugal and Spain joined the European Union. We started to have a sort of a north-south, if not divide, but certainly a differentiation. And then later, in the 2000s, starting in 2004, with the Eastern enlargement. And each time, Europe was enlarged to countries that had lower level of income, lower social standards, lower many factors. And I think the great success of Europe before the crisis, and maybe the greatest achievement in the economic and social field, was indeed what some people have called the fact that Europe has been a convergence machine. It has been able to incorporate countries, poorer countries with lower level of income, lower level of productivity, lower social standards, and create the conditions for convergence. And I think that has been the case, that was the case, first for the southern countries, and then later for the countries of Central and Eastern Europe. And I think that has been a great success. And in a sense, that reinforced the thinking that one can have inside the European Union countries with very different conditions. That the fact that one has those different conditions is not a is not hampering the capacity of Europe to converge. It's possible to take more and more diverse country, and nonetheless, through this convergence machine, the single market, some element of the European budget, and you have recalled that this budget is very small, but is not entirely irrelevant for some countries, that has occurred. Now, one could ask oneself, therefore, whether indeed diversity, heterogeneity, in and of itself, was simply not a problem for Europe. And I think the response was indeed it's not an issue. Now, the question I want to ask, and that's my first point, the question I want to ask, does the same view apply to countries inside a monetary union? And I think what the crisis has shown us is the answer is clearly no. So whereas one can have, in the context of a single market, a great deal of diversity, once countries, a subset of countries from the single market, adopt a single currency, and not just any single currency, but a single currency with certain features, then diversity could be problematic. And economists should not be surprised by that, in a sense. We had known that before the creation of the monetary union. People had been talking about optimal currency area theory and Mandel and all of those issues, and whether there are certain conditions that countries should fulfill in order to enter into a monetary union, and in particular the kind of monetary union that we were building. And one can obviously regret that the criteria that were adopted, the famous Maastricht criteria, the criteria that were adopted to decide whether or not countries would be fit to join the monetary union, were in a sense the wrong criteria. Not the criteria that any economist would have devised, going back to the optimal currency area theory, which would have been sort of criteria in terms of real convergence on a number of features, but rather one adopted in Maastricht criteria related to nominal convergence. And the reason was that, and understandably also given the history of the time, the focus was about monetary stability. So the question was not so much whether sharing a monetary, sharing a currency among a group of countries would allow those countries, in case of shocks, to respond to that. But the question is what whether all of the countries, and that's what Maastricht criteria, whether all the countries would be able to live with a stable currency, in a sense, extending the D mark to the whole Union, and would all countries be fit for that? It was a totally different proposition. And so one, in a sense, ignored the fact that when the euro was put together, was created in January 99, we had in our midst very different countries in many social and economic dimensions. I want to insist also on the social, obviously, because of what you spoke about. So we had very different, very, very different situations. And one could have hoped that the monetary union itself was going to be an engine of further convergence. Maybe that was the hope. We knew, obviously, that Greece, that Portugal, that Spain, that Italy, even though Greece entered a couple of years later, but you know that all of those countries, the periphery, what we call now the periphery, or use other names, that the core and the periphery, those expressions were used then. They're not expressions that date from the crisis. They predate the monetary union, core and periphery. So we knew that we had a core and a periphery, that they were structurally different. And they had different economic and social model. And one could have hoped, and I think one hoped, one could say naively, however you want to call it, and each of us can take the blame for that, including myself, one could hope naively that the convergence would continue via the monetary union, that putting together those two different groups would favor the southern countries, the peripheral country, and that again they would be convergent. Unfortunately, this is not what happened. And so I think one question one can ask oneself, and I come to my second point, talking about economic and social diversity, somebody mentioned before, I think it was Anne, who mentioned the European social model. And as you know, I have written on this topic a little while back, and in a sense attacking this notion, not making a political attack, it's not that I'm attacking the view that one should have in Europe solidarity and all the nice ideas behind the European social model, but I attack that as an economist, because I observe that we do not have a European social model, neither in the EU nor in the euro area. We have a variety of social models. And we have a variety of social models, some being more social than others, some providing more cohesion, some being more, as I used it because I'm an economist, some being more efficient, and some being more equitable. And what I found is that we have countries, Scandinavian countries in particular, but Netherlands fits more or less into this picture as well, that have social models that are both efficient and equitable. And I wrote this in 2005, that's long before the crisis. Then one has countries in the opposite situation, and those are what we call today the peripheral countries, Greece, Portugal, Spain, Italy, that have social models that are neither, that were, not are, were, 2005, were neither equitable nor efficient. And then you have the typical sort of trade-off that people have sort of put forward, sort of the Anglo-Saxon versus the continental. Yes, the British model, the Irish model, being efficient but not very equitable, and the continental model being, yes, equitable, but not very efficient. But I think what one showed there is that there need not be this trade-off. It's not that there is inevitably a trade-off. Yeah, either equitable or efficient. There's some countries seem to be in this trade-off, particularly the UK and France, let's say. But no, others, they can be neither. Or they can be both, like the Nordic, like the Scandinavian. And it seems to me that this situation that was present there, that is still present today, was particularly dramatic in a sense, now benefiting from the being enlightened by the crisis. This situation of heterogeneity in terms of the social models was particularly dramatic already before the crisis for the countries in the euro area. So although I don't disagree, and that's the point I want to make, that's my second one, although I don't disagree with the view that you put forward, that the crisis has increased some of the disparities, including some of the social disparities that you have shown, I wish one insisted a little more on the fact that, as one says that, and as I say, I don't disagree with that, that one at the same time also said that the models of some of those countries were not acceptable models. Socially not acceptable, but certainly not acceptable for countries that were in the monetary union. So I think that needs to be said. So it's not just obviously that, and it's correct, that unemployment today in Greece, in Spain, is 25%. That unemployment rate of the youth is 50%. That is true. That youth unemployment in Italy is 30%. All of this is correct, and all of this is dramatic, no doubt about that. But one has to go back to the fact that before the crisis, those countries, including Spain, you know, you showed the graph of the increased employment rate before the crisis, okay? The objective that we had, the Europe 2020, which was the Lisbon objective, and now we have gone down. But if you look at the improvement of the employment rate, which was substantial just before the crisis, look at the numbers and how much Spain accounts for the improvement of employment rate in Europe. It's incredible. One out of three jobs, a little more actually, one out of three jobs created in the euro area before the crisis was created in Spain. So it was really a job out of thin air. It looked good until one realized that there were jobs in a sector that was going to have a boom and a bust, and this disappeared. So there were a number of features there that were problematic. Third point, I think what we, and there I fully agree with what you said, I think one lesson we can draw from the crisis is that the combination of having free capital movement in the euro area, one of the key features, having a lot of heterogeneity among countries, and not having any mechanism, the banking union, the elements of fiscal union, to deal with problems when they occur, was certainly a recipe for disaster. And there, I fully agree with you when you speak of the deficiency, in a sense, of the original design, and that this design needs to be fixed, and indicated that some of the changes, in particular with respect to the banking union, has already taken place. So I think this is correct. The more difficult question is obviously about the fiscal. And let me come to that. And that was your discussion about sort of a mechanism of stabilization at the euro area level and using unemployment and employment benefits as that. So let me come to that as my fourth point. And I want to put this 4 points in a sort of a somewhat of a broader context than simply the fiscal capacity. I want to see where we are today. And where we are today is certainly, and we see the news, the economic news is not good, sort of we are in this not-ending recession. Okay? So the euro area has been in a prolonged recession now for at least 3 years. Okay? So there was, as you rightly said, there was a first phase, the financial crisis, 2008, then the big recession in 2009, then we came out of the recession, like the US, more or less, okay? And then in the second phase, starting in certainly 2011, beginning of 2012, we got, there was really a divergence with the US or even in the euro area compared to other European countries. So there was, and there is a specific euro area problem. I can say, there's a long recession now going on for 3 years. And we have one quarter where the news is good, and then we are back in sort of bad news. So this prolonged recession of the euro area as a whole. And within the euro area, that's the second feature, so not only the euro area as a whole is doing poorly, including some of the core countries. We see in Germany, certainly not a locomotive, not at all. So we have the euro area in long recession, and within the euro area, some countries, some of the southern countries in particular, particularly in difficult position. So those are the two elements. And this is certainly very, very worrisome, very low real growth, very low inflation, I mean, high debts, all of this recipe indeed for a lot of worry. And I fully agree with you also, the strategy has been always too little too late in a sense, okay? So this ultima ratio, notion that has been there since the start, or imposed by some, was really, you know, we only act when we are on the border of the precipice. It's only then that one gathers the political will to act, and that's certainly, I think, one of the reasons why we are in such trouble. Now, what should we do to get out of this problem, of this long recession? And now I think that we need to act both on the level of policies and on the level of the mechanisms. Okay, so let me say something on both. I think on the level of the policies, my sense is that the speech of Mario Draghi in the US at the end of August in Jackson Hole, putting forward a strategy based on supply and demand is the right strategy. I personally agree that there is a problem of demand, of aggregate demand for the euro area. And for me, it's very easy to say because I've never been a Keynesian. I've never been a Keynesian in normal times. I think that Keynesian in normal times did a lot of damage to Keynesian in the real sense. To me, Keynes was not somebody who put forward a theory for a small recession. He put forward a theory in a situation of a depression. Okay. Now, later, this was interpreted that a small downturn needed to have fiscal boost, and we knew that those measures were always pro-cyclical. By the time the economy was picking up again, measures were implemented and they were pro-cyclical. And I think that discredited much of the, let's say, normal Keynesian policy. But I think a correct understanding of Keynes is indeed telling us that today we have a severe problem of shortfall of aggregate demand, and something needs to be done at a time when indeed households and private sectors need to deleverage. It's not the time for the public sector to deleverage. It has to compensate some of that. So I agree with that view, that one needs to have a demand policy, and demand policy means monetary policy and means the fiscal policy, which it's possible. Not possible, not everywhere in the euro, but it's possible in some. But I think the notion that we also need structural measures in some countries is correct. And it's correct because, in a sense, you could say this original sin of the euro area to have had such heterogeneity in its midst. This heterogeneity that we have in the euro area that could have been predicted would give rise to problems of one sort, not this type of problem, but the problems of one sort or the other, I think is unhealthy. And so I go back to this question of heterogeneity. This heterogeneity on some dimension, including on the social dimension, is not healthy for the euro area. A well-functioning euro area does not mean that all countries need to be identical, doesn't mean that we cannot have diversity, but on some dimensions, this diversity is not healthy. And I think that on labor market and social policies, this is one of the dimensions. So I'm in favor of structural measures, yes, especially for the southern countries. I'm in favor of a euro area demand policy, and I think that's fine. Now, let me come to my last point, and that is your last point, dealing with the mechanisms, in a sense, rebuilding the euro area or changing the organization, the governance, as people call it, of the euro area. One has already spoken about the banking union. I think banking union is very important. I mean, this was missing, obviously, at the start and until very recently, and it's only coming on stream now in the autumn. And so, obviously, had we had a banking union before the crisis, we would be in a much better shape. So, you know, we are 5 years behind. Yes, the US did its stress test in the spring of 2009, and we are doing our stress test in the summer, autumn of 2014. We are 5 years behind, and there you see your graph, and that's certainly one of the reasons. But then the last point is indeed about the fiscal capacity. Now, I have lots of sympathy for the notion that we should have in the euro area some kind of a fiscal capacity. That adjustment in case of difficulty should not be the kind of adjustment that you rightly indicate has occurred, that is pitting the debtor countries against the creditor countries. That is also something that Keynes had warned us and had hoped that the IMF would be able to do, that the IMF would not, obviously the UK situation, the UK was on one side, the debtor, and the US was the creditor. It was exactly that situation. But Keynes, after the war and the creation of the IMF, had argued for that. Now, okay, one could not do that at the global level, but one wish one could have done it for the euro area. Okay, and so I think this notion that of having a fiscal capacity and of a mechanism of fiscal stabilization is a correct one. Is a correct economically, politically, I think, but economically, it is a correct proposal, and I personally support it. Now, do I support, however, and that's where I disagree, and I will finish with this, do I support the fiscal capacity of the fiscal stabilization through a mechanism linked to unemployment? The answer is no, I don't. And the reason why I don't is that we are not the United States. We are not the United States, and we are the United States in what sense? The United States has a labor market. Labor market rules are the same everywhere in the US. And moreover, obviously, unemployment benefits in the US are not very generous, as you know. 26 weeks, unemployment benefits. 26 weeks, 26 weeks, if you can count, 6 months. That's unemployment insurance. After that, on welfare. So, yes, in the crisis, no, the great crisis, this has been prolonged, another 26 weeks, etc. So, the US is a system where you have a unified, in a sense, labor market with lots of mobility, with the same rules, not different social models in different states, as we have in Europe, as I've shown, and very low unemployment insurance. And with that, you can have indeed this federal system that supplements the system that you have at the state level, with those conditions. But we don't have that in Europe at all. We have much more generous unemployment benefits with different duration and different conditions across different countries. We have different social models. And I personally don't agree, but I know the argument. You could say, okay, that explains difference in structural level of unemployment. And so the correction that is made here, we are looking at the cyclical part of the unemployment problem, leaving aside the structural. So the fact that we have different labor market conditions, this is a structural part, okay? So maybe some countries have structurally high, some countries have structurally low, but what we are going to look for the correction, for the fiscal transfers that are involved here, will be based on the cyclical part of the unemployment, okay? So the deviations from the structural. But I think it is not correct. Economically, it is not correct to say that the cyclical and the structural are not linked to one another, and especially in a condition like today, we are not in a normal cyclical downturn. We are in something much more severe. And I think that when you look at the kind of situation that we have today, which is not at all a cyclical problem, it's something much, 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 much deeper than that, then I think it becomes very hard to apply a European system that allows for such differences in labor market and social conditions, and then on top say, well, we'll do transfers to correct for the differences that we observe in the unemployment. I think it's just not feasible. So my view is that it may be feasible one day, but that one day requires not only that we change some of the features of the governance of the euro area, with the banking union, with fiscal union, with a number of other elements, but it requires also some deep structural reforms, including in the social models. Some countries really need to modernize and need to reform their social models to make it compatible, not only with one another, but with their belonging to a monetary union. Thank you very much.
Maybe just a few points in terms of the origin, and then maybe another one concerning the current situation and the alternative. I think in terms of the origin, you stressed that the Maastricht criteria with the long ones. It's important to explore why exactly. It's not that difficult, obviously, to find out, because the intention to have a monetary cooperation and a monetary system in the European Union was always closely linked with the development of the common market and the single market, with the understanding if you have a greater degree of currency stability, i.e. eliminating fluctuation, you have a better chance to exploit the benefits of the single market. So it is very logical. The question is that if you do it through a monetary union which is only a currency board plus, right? So as if unilaterally linking currencies without underlying mechanisms which would otherwise stabilize such a heterogeneous system, are you ending up better or not? And the previous two rounds of monetary cooperation in the 1970s and then in the 1990s were disintegrated exactly because of this fact that the diversity required flexibility, and then eventually the flexibility was allowed to come through by breaking away from the fixed exchange rates, which was possible easily in the 1970s. It was also possible in the early 1990s, but at least for the time being, it's not possible now. While the experience is that only contributes to the deepening divergences and not any kind of stimulus to structural reforms which would allow for a rebound. So you have to be a very strong believer of the J curve if you think that by not allowing any exchange rate flexibility, because you don't have an option, only through structural reforms you will emerge from the crisis. I think it's true that in the current situation, cyclical and structural unemployment are linked to each other, but they are linked to each other in a way that the longer you allow the cyclical unemployment to grow, the more it turns to structural unemployment, right? So the failure, the lack of instruments to respond to the structural unemployment actually aggravate the structural problems of the European Union. And this is, again, something which is totally against the prevailing dogma, because the prevailing dogma is that the crisis is actually a good thing, because it stimulates the structural reforms which countries should have been implementing much earlier. In fact, the crisis accumulates the structural problems, it damages the human capital base, it adds to the unemployability of many people who become long-term unemployed under the current circumstances. The banking union indeed is an interesting phenomenon. Now it is consensus that there has to be a banking union. In 2011, just 3 years ago, nobody spoke about the banking union. The Commission actually produced a green paper on stability bonds, in other name, euro bonds, because it was assumed that intellectually it's not that hard to understand why a fiscal risk sharing is important if we all want to end up better as opposed to worse. The banking union also came as a second best, at least partially, to move towards a risk sharing by also risk mitigation in the good times. But this is practically, in a way, a safety mechanism for the banking sector, assuming, but not for the sake of the banking sector itself, but it assumes that the real economy and at the end society benefit too. For me, this is too long a chain, and I don't have any kind of guarantee that this mechanism actually works, that you stabilize the banks, and then the real economy enjoys it, and then at the end, jobs will be created and society will have less imbalances and problems. I think you would need a shorter cut, and that's why I'm advocating another instrument, which obviously would not be instant, but supplementary to what we discussed.
Thank you very much for your answers.
Our second discussant is Andrea Garnero from the ECARES.
Thanks a lot. So thanks for inviting me here. Even if I understand now that in fact it was a cadeau empoisonné to speak after the commissioner and Professor Sapir. So I'll try, let's say, to be short, because I also know that I'm the main obstacle now between you and the beer in Flagey or City of Excel, so it's already quite late. So first, I would like to congratulate the commissioner for the work he has done in the last two, three years, because it's quite rare that, and unfortunate, that politicians bring ideas. So he has brought some ideas, different ideas, and this one is quite a strong idea. And we are in a period that we are starving for ideas. So when the crisis hit, we did not know what to do. So the economists, today all economists, but the economists, economic profession basically failed because we did not know what to do, or just exposed, we were, let's say, adjusting our arguments to what happened. And the second remark that I would like to make more to you than the commissioner is that this idea might sound to some an idea coming from the left. He is indeed a member of the Socialist Party. However, it is an idea that has been put forward also by more liberal, as we say in Europe, not in the US, but more center-right people like Luigi Zingales in Chicago. But because the basic idea is that we need to accompany to the monetary policy a fiscal policy, and that I think really we are waiting for the European Union and the European countries to do something on that. At the same time, let's say it's not a new idea. It was put forward in the 70s, then it was argued during the debate in the Maastricht for the Maastricht Treaty, and then again in 2012 in the four president report. So when the four president of the Council, the Union, and the ECB, and the rotating president, they put forward a paper establishing a path. So the first path was fixing the public accounts, let's say, sort of done, sort of. Second, banking union, again, sort of done. And then, starting in 2014, so now, going forward a fiscal capacity. Good. That has not been done. We are still in time because it was in the plan was fixed for 2014 and onward. But the debate is quite, let's say, weak. And there is not, let's say,
a big big push toward towards that. So I completely agree with Professor Sapir that some countries, I come from Italy, so from the south, from the periphery, from one of the peaks country, need reforms. We really need reforms, and the focus on that, I think, has been pretty clear. So the Commission each year provides country-specific recommendations for reforms. Perfect. We need reform. I cannot contradict that. But at the same time, we need something also, as I would say, a reform at EU level. So countries are doing something. Okay, good. What is the EU doing? So we have said we have done the ESM, the Banking Union. Professor Sapir has said too little, too late. And I would also add too little, too late, and always different. So when we were facing a crisis, either in Greece, then in Cyprus, then in Spain, then in Ireland, we always applied a different answer to each specific question. So completely unpredictable. Completely unpredictable by markets, completely unpredictable by people, by governments, and so on and so forth. And that is not efficient, and it did not work in the end. So what we need, I was saying something at the EU level. So and now here is my maybe more question and the discussion that I'd like to have with you as a, more as a politician, let's say, as a member of the Socialist Party and the left side. We are currently discussing a grand bargain in Europe between, let's say, France and Italy and Germany on the other side, maybe. So Renzi and Hollande are asking for more flexibility to Angela Merkel. So this is the big debate at the moment. So it seems to me that I would say, so the Socialist Party, even though if it is obviously composed by many national parties, is asking for more, let's say, fiscal leniency or more flexibility to the DPP, to the Popular Party, to the center-right. The center-right was very clear during the hearings of Commissioner Moscovici. They like austerity, they like that countries keep the accounts in order. So the socialists are opposing flexibility, okay. But again, this is a very national solution. There is no EU idea behind that, because basically we are simply asking for a change in the Maastricht criteria. It's not 3%, it's 4%, it's 5%, 20%, whatever. But still, we are not changing the system. We are just keeping the same system with another figure. And they are not asking something more, so they are not asking this fiscal pillar. So the main problem, we said, we had the monetary pillar. So when you do, let's say, your first class in political economy or let's say macroeconomics, they say you have monetary policy and fiscal policy. Again, so here we are not asking for fiscal policy, but more just a different ways of considering surveillance at national levels. Even the very weak and very small idea of contractual arrangements that could have been, in some forms, a form of fiscal capacity, so a fiscal union, meaning contractual arrangements was the idea that in exchange of reforms, some countries, you could guess who, would give, let's say, some fiscal support, so some money, basically. Then there was it was discussed last December during the European Council, it was postponed. The idea is to be, let's say, fought better. It should have been in the agenda of the Autumn Council. I don't know if it is still there or not. It is not. So even this very weak and small idea of having maybe some sort of small budget, EU budget, dedicated to reforms and exchange, so support from countries faring better to countries faring worse, even this has disappeared, and I do not see that the Socialist Party and, the left spectrum of EU policies has supported on that. And the final remark, we are not ready, as said Professor Sapir. Yes, indeed, this is not the solution for today or for tomorrow. It's not the solution for this crisis, a solution for the next crisis, because unfortunately we have to make in mind that in some years, hopefully many years, but we are not going to have a permanent stability at the economic level. However, I would think that we need to think at it now, to discuss it now, to put it in place now, with the time required, maybe not in the next 5 years, but maybe in the next 10 years. And I would like to close reminding something that a similar debate, very different, but let's say similar kind of discussion that the EU had in the 80s when the EU was discussing to put in place the most successful program that the EU has ever had, which is the Erasmus, that some of you might have had. I did it, so it's maybe the biggest success of the European Union. In 86, the EU Council voted against Erasmus because Erasmus is an education tool, is not in the power, let's say, it's not the primary competence of the European Union. So, bureaucrats in the Berlin Wall or somewhere, the Berlin Wall was, I don't know if it was already there or not, and so in the Justus Lipsius said, no, sorry, it's not the competence of the European Union, it's against the treaties and so on and so forth. If this vision, which is legally correct, but I'm not a lawyer, would have prevailed, we would not have the Erasmus. So the same way, I think we should dare to think a bit out of the treaties, if not out of the box, because treaties are not the Bible, far from that. So I really thank you for pushing this debate, and I really hope that this debate will be kept by your successor and by the next commission, because we need something of this sort. Your proposal, another proposal, but we need to discuss this idea.
And two points. One of the points that have been raised by both discussions is the issue of the heterogeneity in the European Union and the Eurozone, and to what extent it justifies proposals like this. And the other question is the current flexibility debate, which of course is not in the center of the economic policy debates, but certainly we can say a few words about that. But first about the heterogeneity. Professor Sapir was emphasizing that because the European countries have all different social models, differently functioning labor markets, for example, as opposed to the United States, this is an obstacle. And I need to come back to this because, again, we spoke about differences in North and South, which is not only an issue of diversity, but very often also an issue of confidence. Whether you really want to be in the same boat with other nations, which may function or behave differently than you do, or what you think about yourself. The United States, from a distance, looks like a homogeneous society. In terms of industrial relations, there are much greater differences between the American North and South than the European North and South. In the American North, especially the Northeast, you have very strongly unionized companies, strong trade union federation in a number of sectors, while in the American South, you have very often a total lack of unionization, which is also politically not acceptable in some of the southern states. So labor mobility is easier in the United States. Nevertheless, studies show that in case of shocks, labor mobility plays a modest role in terms of responding to the asymmetric shocks in the US economy. The fiscal transfers are important. Even if the welfare state is less generous than in most European countries, whether you look at North or South, nevertheless, the fiscal policy, and as you know, the federal budget is much bigger, uncomparably bigger than in the European Union. The federal budget is the key instrument to respond to asymmetric shocks. There are many myths, social mobility, labor mobility in the United States. It's not as big. Social mobility is definitely much smaller than in Europe. Labor mobility is also less than what people believe it is. Which means that if you want to kind of make the European Economic and Monetary Union fit for purpose and respond to the citizens' needs and respect the treaty obligations, we should not simply draw from academic textbooks, if I may just use it in this context, in the sense that you can have a simple model, but you have to choose the model which responds to your actual reality. It is true, nevertheless, that because of the heterogeneity, because of the diversity of social systems and labor market institutions, there is a certain need for harmonization. It is true that you cannot have overnight a kind of fiscal stabilization mechanism which is linked to unemployment. You could have another form which just responds to GDP losses, right? Which is also some type of thinking among experts to dissociate automatic stabilizers from the rise or fall of cyclical unemployment. You can just connect it with what we call the output gap, where the countries are performing according to their economic potential, or they are performing below or sometimes even higher than the potential because of short-term factors. So this is one possibility, of course. And some would say that connecting with the so-called output gap, a compensation mechanism would be more easy in terms of developing it on the basis of the existing treaty. And by the way, for commissioners, the treaty is the Bible. And this is what we have to be responsible for implementing. But it is true that we have to see what works well and what doesn't work well. And of course, the right of initiative also belongs to the Commission if we want to resolve a problem. Now, in my view, the lesson from the past few years is that through the national efforts, whether they are small or big structural adjustment efforts or other type, you cannot resolve the current crisis. You cannot emerge from this major instability. And the problem is that the markets already know that. The markets give some confidence to the Eurozone and to the single currency because a reform process has been launched, because it is assumed that now we can manage the recovery differently than in 2010. And if this sense is lost, of course, we will be in trouble again. The flexibility debate plays in this recovery strategy. In my view, it plays a very limited role because moving on the margins of fiscal flexibility within the rules of the Stability and Growth Pact obviously give you a very limited space for maneuver. It is a very short-term objective. It may create temporarily a better situation for some, which might be needed. Nevertheless, it doesn't resolve the problems on a long-term basis. So what we are speaking about and what the Commission was looking at 2 years ago when developing this so-called blueprint was how to resolve the Eurozone problems for the long term, because we assume that the Euro is there forever. We don't assume that, okay, now we have an experiment with a single currency, and maybe 5 years or 10 years it will not be there. And you cannot assume that seriously. In the treaty, the euro is defined as the currency of the European Union. Nevertheless, after the experience what we have, very few say that the monetary union actually functions well. There's a growing camp which is saying that we should go back to national currencies. Maybe also in this country, but less in this country than in Germany, there is a growing camp. In Italy, there is a growing camp. In other countries outside the Eurozone, there's a growing camp which says, you know, we should never even consider joining the Euro as long as it functions like this. There are less and less who believe that it can be stabilized on the current model, even if it already includes some elements of a banking union. I'm saying some elements because deposit insurance is not there, which was supposed to be introduced when the banking union was agreed 2 years ago. So if there's less and less evidence that we can recover in a sustainable way with the current model, and there is a growing camp of those who say, you know, we should go back to the national currencies, the only other option is to see what else is needed in order to stabilize and ensure that it functions in a more balanced way, which also allows for more prosperity. And the exploration of automatic stabilizers is exactly about this, to ensure that recessions become shorter, recessions become milder, and the growth potential of the EU as a whole increases. We will have less unemployment and certainly better capacity to preserve human capital in the European Union, which is the ultimate growth of ultimate source of growth and prosperity.
I consider, if you look at the social system heterogeneity and the labour market diversity within Europe, the EU economic and social governance developments have done a lot to take into account this diversity in the last years. I think the improvements of EU 2020, the semester, all the economic governance tools have tried to take more and more into account some of the diversities among member states. And my field, of course, being social and labor market, I think improvements have been taking place. But I think there's a dead angle there. And there's a variable on which there hasn't been enough academic research, and the variable on which the Commission hasn't thought enough about is to study more the divergence and convergence of tax systems in their coherence, not in a fragmented way, looking at indirect labor costs or at company taxes or things like that, looking in a coherent way what have been the divergences and convergences previous to the crisis and after the crisis in the tax systems, because it's not only a question for research, it's a question which has practical implications for understanding which are the retombées implications for the recommendations you make. In which environment do these recommendations fall? In which national different environments do they fall? So my question to you is, don't you think there is a black, I know of course the EU has no competence as to taxation and stuff, I mean, but not many competences, but don't you think that this dead angle is a problem? And the second remark has to do with inequalities. Nobody has mentioned Piketty's book, famous Piketty Mania, which has been, of course, reacted by famous economists in the States. Has the Commission looked at that book in Commission circles? What have been reactions vis-à-vis this book? Because one thing which you mentioned, income inequalities, but of course one knows that patrimonial inequalities have been growing much faster than income inequalities in all countries in the world, and we have a problem there. So that's a completely other question instead of personal interest.
I suppose if you have a second question.
It would be good.
Yeah. Pierre,
what?
You have the floor, but I don't have
one. So I have two more precise questions about the social scoreboard you mentioned in your presentation. So my first question is, has this social scoreboard really helped shaping the 2014 country-specific recommendations? Or is that only window dressing? And my second question is, well, without taking into account the legal basis issue, do you think these social indicators should be put on equal foot with the more traditional macroeconomic indicators in the semester? In the sense that, for example, they could trigger sanctions for member states in case of non-compliance with thresholds or something?
Thank you very much, Pierre. Thank you very much, Professor Kirchi, for the questions.
Yes, maybe we start with the scoreboard. The equal footing would require equal legal base, and that under the current treaty is not exactly possible. which means that you can have, of course, you can use the social scoreboard, but not with the same power. The social scoreboard has played already a role in the last 20 years and could play stronger in terms of informing the whole semester process in all its phases, from the annual growth survey, the national reform program, as well as the country-specific recommendations. There were several cases, if you look at the documents from earlier this year, there are concrete references, concrete connections made. Maybe more could be done. Maybe there could be further steps to establish thresholds in order to trigger, in a way, automatic steps, which would need to be ex ante identified. What happens if a certain trigger is reached? Or you could define your ranges. You know, to arrive to a conclusion of whether you should have a trigger or what kind of automaticity or ranges or what where the ranges should be where you consider a country being a in a danger zone would have required very long discussions. Perhaps even now we would not have a scoreboard if you would have wanted to resolve all these questions before putting it on paper. So I think it was better to deliver the scoreboard in 2013 to allow it to play a role first time in 2014 and play already a role in the reflection on the whole Europe 2020 strategy. Because this is what is taking place now since March, there's been officially a consultation about the Europe 2020, which would allow political conclusions early next year by the next Commission, obviously. So I very much hope, and some references have been made to the scoreboard or social indicators during the hearings of several new commissioners, which at this stage should be seen as an encouraging sign of, first of all, awareness, and secondly, conviction that this is a good thing forward in order to rebalance the process. But what I would insist on is that this rebalancing cannot only take place on a country-specific basis. So this is in itself, of course, a first step towards a better model, because the point is not simply that we have imbalances inside individual countries like Spain or Italy, but we have imbalances inside the Eurozone, which would need to be rebalanced somehow. And I should start again my whole presentation, because maybe this would have been a better introduction for the point. Whether we have read Piketty in the Commission, I'm sure there are many references in the speeches of President Barroso already, because we indeed pay attention. Definitely Martin Schulz, before the elections for the European Parliament, had a meeting with Piketty. And I would say indirectly I made a reference, but since he's not a Nobel Prize winner at this stage, I did not highlight his name. When I said that since the 1970s, we have had the increasing inequality in the world and including in many European countries, because that's the basic message, that there was a period maybe between the 1930s and the 1970s in the post-depression, post-war model of capitalism, when there was a capacity to control or even reduce inequalities. And then since the 1970s, the opposite is true, and indeed he arrives to taxation as the main message. But in order to counteract inequalities through taxation, of course, you need a very broad coordination under the G20. In a way, this international coordination extended to taxation, but I would say because of the legal constraints, it can only go step by step, in the European Union, this commission actually made a proposal for a financial transaction tax. But there is one member state which is challenging it at the court. Nothing is very easy.
I'm afraid that we don't have time for other questions from the audience. I'm sure our students learned a lot from this debate and from this discussion. It reminds me to thank you once again for your presence and for this debate this evening, and to express on the behalf of the Institute that this today's lecture is the beginning maybe of a close cooperation and collaboration with the Institute for European Studies. Thank you very much to our students, to our colleagues, representatives and authorities of the ULB. Have a nice weekend and see you the next week. Bye.
Thank you.